not a worry. So,
I'll go check and see how close he is.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Let me know. I'm sorry. Praise the Lord, Turnpoint Church. How's everyone doing tonight? Fantastic. Why don't you stand to your feet with me? We're excited about tonight's service, looking in anticipation of what God is going to do here tonight. Amen? Amen? Amen. Before we get started, I have a few quick announcements for you. Tonight, we are here. We're going to have a fantastic service. But after that service, we're going to have a time of celebration and appreciation for all of you. All of you that were involved in our summer outreach programs with our July 4th program, a parade down in Groveport with VBS, Vacation Bible School, that was phenomenal with so many kids getting the baptism of the Holy Ghost. What a great time. Yes, hallelujah. That's what it's all about. And then also with our August 13th Community Connect, what a fantastic opportunity that we had to touch our surrounding areas. So everybody that's been involved with that, we want to celebrate you and all the volunteers. So any of your support and planning, so we're going to have that after service. Everyone say after service. We'll get there. So, but this week, all marrieds, if you are married in the room, why don't you just wave your hand and give me a little hey. All right, there you go. So this applies to you. We've recently just had our last all-marriage session, which was the art of marriage this past Friday. Brother Cobb and Sister Cobb, I talked with them. They said that we had a great class, but they said that we have another one coming up this coming Friday, August 26th, back in the Youth Center at 7 p.m. It applies to anyone and everyone. You can jump in at any time. I promise you, you will be blessed by these sessions. They are new sessions. We are not doing the old sessions, so this is brand new material applicable for anybody that's been married 1 week, 1 year, 1 decade, and we will not worry about the rest. After that, Foundations 2. Foundations 2 will be our next class starting on August 31st. So if you've already taken Foundations 1 and you want to go deeper, you want to find out more, Foundations 2 is a great place for you to do that. So please check in with Brother Scott Hamill, Sister Sheila Hamill. They can help you with that, getting registered, or you can go to the app and find out about Foundations 2. Sign up under forms. And last but not least, Sunday, September 18th. Sunday, September 18th is a great time that we're going to have with all of our TP kids. It's when we have a night of worship. Basically, all of our TP kids get together and they will come up here and they will sing. They will preach. I've had some of them get up here and just do all of the different things that they do, the talents that God's given them. They were going to show you what they can do for God. So we're excited about them. But for you to participate, we need you to sign up by September 7th. Everyone say September 7th. Parents, TP Kids, make sure that you know, TP Kids, September 7th is the deadline. If you have questions, you can go to the app. Again, under forms, you can find all that information out. And you can also see Stephanie Rogers or Melissa Deborah. They can help you with that, okay? So I'm going to ask you, turn to the person next to you and just give them a high five. Turn to the other person and say, I'll give you the same. And so right now, before we get started with service, I'm coming in anticipation of what God's going to do. I feel a celebration in the house tonight. God is good. God is great. And I promise you, God is coming to do something in this service. Let's begin to open this service with a resounding sound of worship, with praise. He's worthy. Come on, lift up your voice and say, God, you're worthy in the house. We magnify you. We glorify you. There's no one like you. We give you praise.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we've come to bless your name tonight, God. Oh, yes, Jesus. Oh.
Spirit pouring out on us. Oh God, we need revival, stir it up. Oh God, we just want you.
Oh yes, we just want you, yeah.
We just want you.
Glory to your name, oh God. Oh, creation waits.
Creation waits.
Your people long for you.
Your people long for you.
We anticipate.
We anticipate a mighty move.
Well, we're leaning.
We're leaning.
We're trusting.
Trusting.
Patient.
Patient.
We're waiting.
We're waiting.
We're desperate.
We're desperate. Come,
come,
come, come,
come,
come,
come,
come,
Lord, your perfect love cast, love cast without all fear. Hallelujah, Jesus, reveal your love. Yeah, God Almighty, glory to your name, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we bless your name, oh God. Oh, we worship you in this place, oh God. You're worthy of praise, worthy of honor. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Can we just all across this room, it's okay. Things don't always go to plan, but he's still faithful. He's still worthy. We praise your name. We praise your name, oh God. Let your kingdom come and your will be done tonight. Yes, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. You're worthy, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name, Jesus. We praise your name, God. All across this room, we praise you, yeah. Oh, lift up your praise to God tonight. You reign, you reign, you reign.
Blessed assurance, for Jesus is mine. And oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.
Sing it together.
Heir of salvation, I'm purchased of God. Born of His Spirit, oh, I'm washed in His blood.
Oh,
and I can't stop singing.
Oh,
oh, this freedom song. Sing it loud, praise is pouring out,
praise is pouring out,
and I will dance,
and yeah. I will dance in your freedom now.
You have brought me out,
you have brought me out,
you have brought me out,
you have brought me out.
Oh. Everybody clap unto God, yes, Jesus. Blessed assurance,
Jesus is.
If you know that, sing it in the room. Salvation.
Salvation.
I'm purchased of God.
Purchased of God.
Born of His Spirit.
Born
yes, Jesus.
Spirit.
I'm washed in His blood.
Oh.
And I can't stop singing.
Oh,
oh, this freedom song.
Oh.
I'm praising my Savior.
I'm a devil.
I got a song and I sing it loud. Praise is pouring out, praise is pouring out. And I will dance in your freedom now.
You have brought me out,
you have brought me out. I got a song and I sing it loud. Praise is pouring out, praise is pouring out. And I will dance in your freedom now.
Testimony tonight.
Did He heal you?
Yes.
Did He free you?
Yes.
Did He save your soul?
Yes.
Did He make you whole?
Yes, yes.
Did He wash you?
Yes.
Transform you?
Yes.
Redeem you?
Yes.
Did He cleanse you?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Did He give you?
Yeah.
singing loud. Praise His glory now. Praise His glory now.
And I will dance.
And I will dance in the freedom now.
You have brought me out.
You have brought me out.
You have brought me out.
All I want.
Oh, we love you, we love you,
we love you.
ceases to exist.
When you walk into the room,
the dead begin to rise.
have it all, God. Hallelujah. For you and you alone. Hallelujah. We just love him right now. Would you just express to him that your motivation for everything you do is to please him. Lord, I please you tonight, God. Let my worship rise up, God, as an incense to worship you, to please you, to honor you, God, and to glorify your name. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Wonderful presence of the Lord in here tonight. Amen. We need to pray for Nellie Whitehill's sister, Priscilla Barley, and in an accident in Florida. She's in the hospital. So let's pray for Priscilla Barley tonight, and that God would touch her and Tanya Seymour's aunt, Betty, that God would touch her and give her strength in Jesus' name. Amen. Been in the hospital for a month, and hasn't eaten much in that month, so let's pray that God would return her appetite, heal her body, and raise her up. In Jesus' name, I believe the Lord can do it. Lord, we thank you tonight, God. We give you all the glory, God, for everything that you've done. Done in our lives and done in this house, God. Every healing, every provision, everything that you have done to mend people. In their minds, hearts, souls, bodies. We give you the glory, God. You are the source of all healing. You are the source of all provision. And God, I pray, Lord, that Betty tonight would be touched by the blood of Jesus and raise her up. Smite this sickness in her body. God, give her an appetite to eat, Lord. In Jesus' name, touch Priscilla Barley tonight, God. Keep her safe. Lord, raise her up. Let her body be whole in the name of Jesus Christ. Bless those that are not well tonight. Strengthen them. And we give you the praise and the glory. Receive our tithe and offering as worship to you. For you are worthy in Jesus' name of our praise. Amen. God bless you as you give tonight.
No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God.
Thank you, Jesus. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Set a fire in my soul. Amen. There's a fire coming that's going to try every man's life. And he said, that which will be burned up, but that which remains will remain. I want to ask the Lord to burn it up now.
Burn up everything that doesn't matter. Burn up every desire that's not what it should be,
so that my life can be on fire for God and His kingdom. Amen? Praise God. Good to see you in the house tonight. Praise God. I want to pick up, I guess, tonight where we left off two Sunday mornings ago. I feel to come back to this, and so I'm going to do that with the help of the Lord, and it's sort of a prophetic declaration and an assessment of where we are in the Spirit. And if you're thinking big thoughts and praying big prayers, God has bigger things in mind. He's an exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think God. Amen. He is not thinking small. He is thinking globally. He is thinking the entire earth. And it's going to happen because it's His plan and His word. And we talked about the tsunami that hit Indonesia in 2004 when a 9.2 magnitude earthquake hit the earth, released within the earth, and shook our planet, knocking it off its axis by an inch. And that's a lot. When you're talking something as massive as the entire globe, triggering a 100-foot-high tsunami wave that reached multiple continents, moving islands several feet, forever altering the landscape along the coastlines for several hundred miles, 250 dead, another 200,000-plus missing and never accounted for. They were sucked into the sea, never to be seen again. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? That's how powerful this wave was that hit. And you and I are sitting here tonight. You can be seated. I thank you for standing. I've got scripture, and I'll get to it here in a moment. But this combination of the earthquake tsunami was labeled a mega thrust. A mega thrust. It's believed that this earthquake was simmering for about 200 years beneath the crust of the earth, underneath the ocean. And it was released in a moment's time. That's pretty amazing to think something would be building for that long and be released in a moment's time. 200 years of pressure, power, building up under the ocean surface. I believe that we are experiencing a spiritual mega thrust, a move of God's Spirit that began building 2,000 years ago, and it's been prophesied since the days of the prophet Joel that this latter rain outpouring would come. It will be like nothing we've ever seen before. It will be like nothing the world has ever seen before. A revival so powerful and wide-sweeping that the entire globe will feel its effect. Multiple continents will be impacted. Spiritual landscape will be changed forever. Amen. We have seen and heard of localized revivals and outpourings, some of them, a few of them in our lifetime, mostly before. but they're usually confined to a nation or a localized region. Jerusalem was the first epicenter of revival. That revival shook the then known world. The Bible says that the disciples turned their world upside down. But yet it was contained to a region. There was the Welch Revival, Topeka, Kansas, Azusa Street Revival, most of those affecting their continent. The Ethiopian Revival, that's the one that many of us can relate to because we have heard and seen the videos of the people that have gathered under tents, a million at a time. Thousands of people, 100,000 people plus, receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost in one service. Signs, miracles, creative miracles happening under that same tent. And it's just a glimpse of a smaller, it's a tremor in comparison to what's going to come to the earth. The historical account of this earthquake and tsunami, this mega thrust, said that they could start feeling the tremors ahead of this earthquake. It wasn't the earthquake, but it was the tremors. It was the anticipated release of power that was about to hit the earth, and it began to tremor on the Richter scale before it totally erupted into this mega thrust earthquake. And these revivals that I've referred to are just simply tremors. Tremors on the scale, tremors on the radar, things that God has allowed to begin to happen. But it's not the end time revival that is prophesied to us through the Word of God. What we're going to see is going to be a culmination, a crescendo of these revivals hitting at one time. A release of spiritual outpouring like the world has never seen before. And I did not get to finish this message, but I want to begin where we left off, because I do believe that God is about to do things that we have not yet seen before. We're further from the New Testament outpouring in the book of Acts than we've ever been, but we're closer to the end of time than we've ever been. We're closer to the last day harvest than we've ever been, and it's not that it's not going to happen, it's just a matter of when it's going to happen. Amen. I just want to touch on four major characteristics of this supernatural dimension that is coming to the earth. I believe COVID was a conditioning of society to understand that there are things that people have looked to for security for a long time that were shaken and removed as things that you could lean on, things that you depended on. Amen. It's God saying, no, just get ready because I'm shifting things in the earth. And there's going to be a shaking and a shifting, the Bible says, so that the things that can be shaken will be shaken, to show the things that cannot be shaken and they will remain. I don't know about you, but I plan to be a part of that thing that cannot be shaken. There's a lot going on in our world today. There's a lot of things shaking, amen. And it appears on the surface that there has been a stabilization of the things that were shaken. But I've got news for you. There are things that have been shaken that are never going to stop shaking. If you're putting your hope in anything but God today, you're going to be disappointed, because the Lord is allowing things to be shaken so that our trust will be in Him. Four major characteristics of this dimension. And how will I know it's the end time move of God? The supernatural power has begun to be released in this mega thrust, if you will. And I believe there are some characteristics that we can look around and see that God is allowing to happen. And the first characteristic I believe that we can see is that God is bringing about radical changes in the church to raise it to a new level of spiritual maturity and authority.
Amen. The Lord has shaken a lot of things that weren't really spiritually sound in order for things that are sound to be established. He is bringing about an authority that does not come from man, but it comes from Him. So that He can use the authorities and the powers that are ordained of Him and channel it through that which He can pour out His miracle working power. I believe that the Lord is still shaking the church. He's shaking the church from a corporate business model to a spiritual biblical model, where the fivefold ministry is what He runs everything through. Amen. We're not used to it, but God is saying, that's the only thing that's going to work. That's the only model that I ordain. That's the only model that I endorse. Nothing else will work because it's tainted by the arm of flesh. God says, I'm done working through the arm of flesh. I will do it my way. That's what's coming to the earth. Second thing God is doing is He is bringing the church to a new level of revelation, of knowledge, whereby He will reveal Himself in an intimate communion and fellowship. What are you saying? I'm saying that just coming to church on Sunday and Wednesday and thinking that's a relationship, God says, I can't work with that. He is bringing the church to a new level of revelation where He wants to reveal Himself through intimate communion and fellowship, where His glory will be manifested in the midst of His people. Last Sunday night should not be some sort of unique service. When the glory of the Lord comes in and His cloud comes into the room and it just shuts down things and rearranges schedules, that's what God is pressing into the church. He is saying, that's how I want to move. I don't need you to prop me up and sort of, you know, make me work. He says, I'm looking for a place to work. Who will let me? The Lord says, I'm doing a new thing in the earth. Amen. And I need people who will allow me to just move how I want to move. Deeper consecration is coming. Deeper consecration is coming. Persecution is forcing the church to dig for deeper intimacy. Yeah. Talk to the people in China about whether it's about trying to get to church on Sunday or trying to get into His presence on Sunday. It's not just about structure and habit and routine. Amen. This new thing that's coming to the earth is an intimacy, a fellowship. The third thing God is going to do in this last hour is there are going to be called out believers who have given themselves fully to God and will be empowered to do the work of the ministry, not just well-known evangelists, pastors, teachers, and ministers. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Shomer Shabbat, what does that mean? That's the watchman in Ezekiel.
I'm going to keep on teaching. I receive that word. That's a confirmation to what I'm saying. And Brother James joins us in intercessory prayer, and God uses him. But I'm expressing this because this is where we're headed. And if we're not in sync with what God is doing, it's going to take us off kilter.
It's going to rock our world. It's going to be different. And if we're not careful, we will miss it. Can I just say it like this? The Lord, amen, was not received when he came to earth by the people that were prepared and should have been ready to receive him, because he didn't come like they thought he was going to come. And they missed him because God, he didn't fit in their box. He didn't fit in their religion. He didn't fit in how they were doing things. He didn't fit in man's mold. And so God says, I can't do this. I can't come among you and do, I can't bring my kingdom among you, because you've got your own kingdom functioning, and I'm looking for a place to work, and I'm going to have to go over here to the Gentiles. I'm going to have to go over here to some people who don't care what it looks like, but they embrace who I am and what I want to do. And that's what God is saying again to us in this last hour. He's saying, I'm not going to do it your way. I'm not going to do it the institution way. I'm going to do it my way, and my way is going to work. So get ready. God is going to use the fivefold ministry, but he's going outside of fivefold ministry. I've taught it here for as long as I can remember, but it's not just the pulpit that God is going to use in this revival. It's the pew. And until the pew gets engaged with what God is trying to do, we're going to miss what God's trying to do, because God never intended for just a few people to go around and do all the preaching and the work. God says we're to equip the saints so that the saints can be released to do what God's going to do. I'm preaching your Bible tonight. It's to equip the saints, but we as saints and we as the body need to be in the mindset that says, you know what, God, whatever you want me to do, I'm here to do. Whatever these hands can do, whatever these feet can do, whatever this mouth can do, I'm here to spread your kingdom and spread your gospel. This is intentional. God is saying, I'm not going to be limited to a handful of people, even though I have gifted them. Do you realize the fivefold ministries are the gifts from God to the church? You know how he chose to describe the fivefold ministry? And he gave some. If you give something, it's a gift. He gave gifts to the church. He gave people that were to raise up and teach and preach and inspire and equip people to do a broader base work. That's who he's going to use in the last hour. He showed us this at Azusa Street. You know the Azusa Street revival. Amen. It was a revival largely fired through teenagers. William Seymour is the person that many people attributed to the great revival at Azusa Street. And yes, he was instrumental, but it was the young people, it was the teenagers, the early teens, 12, 13, 14 years old, that God moved on, and they would lay hands on people and they would prophesy and people would be healed and miracles would happen when teenagers would lay their hands on them. He was just showing us a little glimpse into what it's going to be in the end time. It's not going to be everybody you think it's got to funnel through, but he's going to look for passionate people who say, if you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. I'm willing to do it, God. I'm willing to step out and do it. Finally, as a wave of God's miracle power sweeps the cities of this nation and across the world and continents, the world will have a final end time witness of the gospel of Jesus Christ preached in demonstration of supernatural power, resulting in unprecedented worldwide harvest of souls. You know what I believe the Lord's going to do? I believe he's going to turn the evil devices for his good. I believe that God's going to
show people healings and mass outpourings on social media like he's doing, but it's going to ratchet up to a new level. He's going to use the tool the devil uses to try to spread evil, and he's going to take it and he's going to spread the gospel. He's going to let the church use these tools. There's no substitute for one-on-one evangelism. That's God's model. But I'm talking about something so broad and bigger that God is going to use every tool available to reach this world. We don't have time. It's 2022. God's not just interested in filling up a building at 7718. He's interested in sweeping across the world with an ingathering of souls. As it relates to this word megathrust, I think it's important to understand how much in line with Scripture it is. John 14:12, "Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." We have preached this, but we're not living in it. We see a smattering of miracles and we shout over one or two, and we should celebrate that. Please don't misunderstand me. But God is saying to us, hey, everywhere I went, I healed the sick. Every person I came in contact with, I delivered from demonic spirits. There was no place that I went that they had faith that I couldn't do great and mighty works. And I'm telling you that I've got to leave so that you can do greater than what I've been doing. He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he, us, you, do also. And greater works than these shall he, ye, you, do. Because I go to my Father. He speaks in a very general term here. He who steadfastly believes in me. That brings us back to the unshakable people. People that have faith in the middle of the storm, like we talked about this morning. The people that walk with God and doesn't always go their way, but they still believe God's a healer. They still believe God's a provider. They still believe that God is a sovereign God in control of all things at all times and all places. And he speaks in general terms here, but he's very specific on what we are going to be doing. He says you're going to see things done at a greater increase in numerical fashion than you've ever read about in the Word of God, because I'm leaving here, but I'm not leaving the mission undone. I'm leaving it in your hands because I want my church to take up my cause and to run with what I started. He said, you're going to be able to do the same things, only in a greater capacity. Through increased opportunity, anointing, potential. I don't know if you all believe this stuff, but I do. Amen. I believe that God can do anything. My wife was talking about Sister Nona Freeman in the airport in Africa. They were apprehended. They were stopped. They were being blocked from getting through security. I'm talking years ago, before TSA and all this goofy stuff that we have to deal with now. It was spiritual opposition. But they were in that airport with their luggage and their PA system and everything they had brought to Africa to try to start evangelizing. And when they got there, Sister Freeman said that they were blocking them and said, "You are not going into you're not coming into the country, and you're not bringing that stuff in." And all of a sudden, a gentleman with a fine suit came up to them with a piece of chalk in his hand, and he started putting X's on all of their boxes and luggage. Amen. And the men that were there blocking them just kind of stood back like they knew this dude had the corner office. And so they just stood back, and this man turned to them and said, "All of these boxes are going through." He gave them absolute clearance into the country. When they got past security, he looked at them and said, "The man you're looking for is going to be on the left, down there on the left. You'll see him and you'll notice him, and you can't miss him because he's there waiting on you." They had no contact with anyone. They didn't prearrange any meetings. But God said, "You're going into the country. I don't care what's trying to stop you or hold you back. Yeah, you heard Brother Smith talk about, amen, Sister Chenault and her visiting, amen. It was actually her visiting the Freemans in Africa. And she was in prayer in Oklahoma one day, and all of a sudden she shows up in Africa, and they didn't know how she got there. And she comes back to America and never boarded a plane because God translated her from Oklahoma to Africa and back. You say, "Oh, I don't know if I believe all." I'm telling you, it happened whether we believe it or not, because there's record of it. And God is saying, "I'm not limited to what you think or what you perceive. I am ready to do a work that will blow your mind." Yeah. That's the God I serve. It's going to be an increased opportunity. God's bringing an increased anointing. God's bringing increased potential. And the tools of evangelism available to us supersede anything we've ever seen before. We should accept nothing less than exponential growth and revival and outpouring of the Holy Ghost. But you and I have to be in sync with what God is trying to do in the earth. And our spirit needs to be yes and amen. Yea and amen. God, whatever you want to do, I'm in alignment with you. I'm in agreement with you. The former and the latter reign together. It's pretty obvious that that is speaking of a time period. Former, latter, time period. An initial major outpouring and a second major outpouring. The latter rain also speaks of increase in volume. It's not just time frame, it's volume. Are you with me tonight? It's not just time frame. It's not just Book of Acts in 2022, Azusa Street. It is that. But it's also speaking of increase in volume. Latter rains are seven times greater than former rains in Scripture. I want you to look at Deuteronomy 11, 14. Actually, we'll read 13 and 14. "And it shall come to pass, if you shall hearken diligently unto my commandments, which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God and serve him with all your heart and with all your soul." That's where we are, church. It's a call. It's a call away from lukewarmness. It's a call away from apathy. God said, "If you'll do this, that I will give you the rain of your land in his due season, the first rain and the latter rain, and thou mayest gather in thy corn, thy wine, and thine oil." The former rains produced grain. The latter rains are going to produce olives and grapes. or the typology is oil and wine, and this speaks of an increased spiritual activity in the latter time. It's not just a harvest of grain or people, but there is a spiritual harvest coming to the earth. It involves people, but it also expands, amen, and it is an increased anointing that is coming to the earth where the Holy Ghost is going to flow, amen, at a very increased capacity. First outpouring was church government, the word, order, apostolic doctrine, Jesus, the bread of life, the initial outpouring of 120 in the upper room, amen, and then throughout Europe and the Middle East and Asia. But the latter rain, amen, is God saying, I'm going to pour out my spirit, not just on a city and not just on a region, but I'm going to pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. It's going to hit the entire world, amen, and it's going to be wine and oil available to all in abundance, praise God. It's going to be a 7-time increase of outpouring on the earth, a mega thrust, if you will, an earth shaking revival that will change the landscape and be felt by the entire world. If the letter, amen, is 7 times greater than the former, amen, 7 times greater than the book of Acts, is going to hit the earth, and it started now, and it will only continue to increase. James chapter 5 and verse 7 says this: be patient therefore, brethren. Well, if it was going to happen, bless God, it would have happened by now. No, it's happening, and it's getting ready to be released as a mega thrust. Be patient, therefore, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, we don't preach this very much when we talk about end times, but we should. The husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth and has long patience for it until he receive the early and the latter rain. In other words, God says, I am going to reap a harvest in the entire world. Be ye also patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. He said the coming of the Lord is coming. But there's going to be a harvest because the Lord is patient. And he's waiting on the harvest of the early and the latter rain. The husbandman, the owner of the vineyard, is waiting for the precious fruit of the earth. What is the precious fruit of the earth? The souls of men. The latter rain is equivalent to this mega thrust that is going to continue to sweep the world, and we're going to see it. I'm going to see it. I'm going to be a part of it.
If I'm not, then I'm going to die believing I'm going to see it.
And I want to prepare the next generation to be a part of it. But I fully intend to believe that God is going to let us see what he's doing, because his coming is nigh. It's close. It's at the door. You ever been on an elevator? Amen. Going up the elevator and you're standing too close to the door like we do, because you're ready to get off, and the door opens and there's somebody right there in your face trying to get on. I believe in the Spirit that's where we are. We're ready to leave this world and the Lord's ready to come, and we don't realize how close it is, because it's just going to be like one day hitting the floor and the door opens and there's Jesus. It's that close. It could be at any moment, any time. Amen. But the Lord says, I'm patient for this fruit. It's my vineyard. They're my souls. We can't comprehend how much the Lord loves people because we didn't die for them. And the Lord isn't just going to look at his vineyard and say, well, I guess I'll just let the rest of them rot. He's the husbandman. He's planted us. He has planted the people. People have watered. Amen. And there's a great harvest ready to be reaped. You say, I don't know. How is he going to do that? There's a lot of people that don't even know about God. I believe the Lord's letting a generation grow up that doesn't have a lot of stuff to unlearn, so that when the truth comes to them, they'll be ready to receive what the truth is. Soon to close. So at intercessory prayer this week, my wife was teaching and referring. Actually, it would have been last week now. She made a statement that we are, based on this message a couple of weeks ago, encouraging us to ride the wave. When she uttered that phrase, immediately God spoke to my spirit and said, that's where we are. If you ever watch surfers, I don't know if we can pull that video up. It was from 2 weeks ago, or last week, excuse me, Sunday night. You ever seen the surfers out there surfing? Has anybody here ever surfed? A few people? Awesome. Correct me if I'm wrong. Hold on a second. Just push pause. Good place to pause it. These people, when they are surfing, you know, you've seen them out there kind of paddling around, laying on their belly, right? Paddling around, paddling around. What are they doing? They're trying to catch a wave. They're trying to feel what the water's doing beneath them. You can't just stand up on your board when there's no rise in the water. That's not surfing. You got to feel it. And every once in a while, a wave will come through and they raise up and they keep paddling. What are they doing? They're waiting to feel the wave that they need to catch rise up beneath them. And when that water begins to rise, they begin to position themselves just like this individual. You can let it play, because this in the spirit is about what we are trying to do as the church. I don't know about that right there. So here it is. You see that person stood up on the crest and they're riding the wave. And it's you got to position yourself right to ride it to its fullest extent. That wave just keeps rolling. That person's not going to stop that wave. They can't do anything about the wave. Only ride it or be swept under by it. And I'm telling you, what's coming to the earth is just like that giant wave of revival. We're either going to get it, we're either going to catch it, or we're going to be swept under by it because we weren't positioned for it. I don't know about you, but I'm going to keep on paddling, and I'm going to keep on staying in position until God raises that wave so high that he's going to do amazing things, and I'm going to be a part of it. I'm going to ride it. Yeah. Positioning, waiting, reading the water, looking for the right timing to catch the wave. At the conclusion of the prayer service, the Lord spoke to us, and I want to read this to you, what he said to us. He said, be encouraged this day, for every word I have spoken is true, and it will come to pass. For as in the days of Noah, they had not seen rain, but it did rain. I sent rain to destroy the earth, but this time my flood will come to save you, because it will be a flood of my spirit, a flood of revival, a flood of redemption, a flood of miracles. I'm coming to save. Be assured that it is raining now. Look to your natural world to see what is happening. There are floods everywhere. It is a sign to you in the natural that my spirit is falling and flooding the earth now. Pay attention and be observant, for I am moving, says the Lord. My flood will displace things that seem immovable, and it will change the landscape because I will have my way. My flood cannot be stopped. I sit as king on the flood. I sit on the flood. I have my way in the flood. The flood is here. The rivers are rising. The rain is falling. The fountains of the deep are being broken up. I'm coming, but not before I send my flood. Not before I save the earth. Those who will refuse to move will perish in the same flood that was sent to save them. My word is true. I'm pleased with your prayers. I'm pleased with your preparation. For Noah obeyed my voice even when he didn't understand what a flood was. He prepared. Keep preparing. Keep praying. Keep believing, for what I say will come to pass. God is sovereign, folks. We've got to be ready. On this video, I was watching about this wave and catching the wave. And musicians, you can come. I'm finished. But they said that one day you have to be consistent in looking for the waves, because one day you'll go and there will be nothing there. It'll be flat. And the next day you'll go and you'll catch a wave that's 50 to 80 feet tall. It's kind of like the prophet who said, go look again. Do you see anything happening over there? No, it's clear skies. No outpouring today. Well, go again. Go again. Go again. And he finally came back and he was paddling his board, waiting on God and saying, Lord, I'm going to be here when it's time. When the rain's beginning to fall, when the flood's beginning to rise, I'm going to be in position and ready to catch, amen, what you're going to do in the earth in the last hour. Amen. And he finally came back and said, there is a cloud the size of a man's hand. He says, you better get out of here. It's fixing to rain. There's about to be a mega thrust released on the earth. There's about to be an outpouring of God's Spirit like never before. Can I tell us in this house tonight? Amen. I don't know exactly when and where and how it's all going to happen, but God is sending a mega thrust, a revival, a tsunami, amen, that's going to reshape the landscape and shake the earth off of its axis, because God is sovereign and he's going to move before he comes back. As a sign, he said, look around. Las Vegas has been flooded twice. Sin City, the Strip. You can stand with me. The place where people go for sin and fun and pleasure. God says, I'm going to flood this place. I'm going to wash it clean. I'm going to bring my spirit as a witness into this city. Amen. Death Valley has been flooded. Isn't that amazing that Sin City and Death Valley have both been flooded? The Lord said, pay attention. Sin City's not powerful enough to hold me off. Death Valley's not hot enough and dry enough to prevent me from bringing life when I want to bring it. Flash floods in Kentucky, flooding in Denver, Colorado, flooding in Seoul, South Korea. City of 23 million people underwater. Flooding in Mexico, St. Louis, Virginia, Ecuador, Brazil, southern Montana. Yellowstone Park closed down. Argentina, Cuba, Colombia. Brother Bixby, I remember the prayer meeting. You showed the video clip of the lady talking about the crisis going on amongst the Muslims and the Islam faith. They're estimating that 15 to 16,000 Muslims are leaving the Islamic faith every day. And they're turning to Christianity. What in the world is that if it's not the Lord saying, I can do anything. Stuff you thought was impossible is possible with me because it's my sovereign harvest and I am the Lord of the harvest. I am the Lord of the harvest. If you'll put Revelation 14, I want to read Revelation 14 in closing tonight. I'm not preaching this tonight as a response message or something to make us feel better. It's what the Lord is trying to say to the church. Hey, before I come, there's going to be a latter rain outpouring. And he said in Revelation 14, 14, and I looked and behold a white cloud, and upon the cloud sat one like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time is come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. He didn't say the harvest of Columbus is ripe, the harvest of America is ripe, the harvest of Africa is ripe. He said the harvest of the earth is ripe. And the Lord of the harvest is about to thrust in that sickle. And he used this terminology to let us see it's a sharp sickle. And I'm not going to keep hacking at the harvest. When I send my sickle through the harvest, I'm going to gather the harvest of the earth. And there's going to be an ingathering like you've never seen before. I don't really know how to close tonight, but I would just invite us to come up around this altar if you can see what the Lord is doing and you're in agreement that I'm living in the time where the Lord is about to reap the harvest of the earth. I pray the Lord speaks to you about your role in the harvest. It's not just for a handful of ministry and those who hold license and credentials, it's everyone who's willing to put your hand to the plow. He didn't say, hey, we got a lot of time for the harvest. He said, don't say there's 4 months until harvest. Look up and lift your eyes on the harvest. The fields are white and ready to harvest. He said, pray that the Lord of the harvest sends forth laborers. There's not a harvest problem. There's a labor problem. So tonight, would you just hold your hands out to the Lord if you're willing? Say, God, I don't know what I can do, but I feel a witness, God, that your coming is at the door. Your coming, Lord, and the thrusting in of the sickle are simultaneous, God. It's like they're happening together. You said the husbandman of the earth is patient, but when he's out of patience and he's ready to harvest, then the coming of the Lord is going to be upon us because the Lord's going to reap and then he's going to come. Shatana namo ho re baba bahaya. Lord, let your harvest, God, be reaped. I don't want to be taken out by the mega thrust, by the tsunami that's coming. The Lord sent tremors to us. He sent, amen, waves to prepare us, amen, to get ready to catch His last and final wave of revival. I believe it's time to stand up and ride the crest, because God is doing a work that is end time. Greater things than these shall you do. Jesus' name, speak, Lord. Speak, Lord, to your people, God. Hallelujah, Jesus.
I've seen the faithfulness of God, the still inside the storm, the promise of the shore. I trust the power of your word.
Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus, I love you, Lord.
There isn't one that is delayed, so I will not lose heart. Here I will take my arms and start to sing into the night.
Hallelujah. I want us to get with two or three people and form a circle. And I want us to begin to intercede for laborers. We're not interceding for the harvest tonight. But we're going to say, God, we're going to partner with what you're doing in the earth today. And I want you to use my brother, my sister, and myself, whoever you're with. Would you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost? Amen. The devil doesn't like this. He hates it because he's doing everything he can to try to prevent the church from seeing what God's doing in the earth. But we need our eyes open to what God is doing and what he's trying to do in the earth today. It's bigger than us. It's bigger than a local assembly. Amen. It is an earth-wide outpouring of his spirit, a reaping of the harvest of the earth. Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, you want to fill up every house. You want to fill up, God, every person with your spirit. God, pour out your spirit upon all flesh. Lord, let us go forth as laborers. Let us be mindful of the harvest. Let us be mindful of the harvest. Amen. I want the voice of our prayers to fill this house right now. Without music or anything else, just for a moment. Would you let intercession begin to break out? Would you let prayer go up for your lost loved ones? Amen. God, turn their hearts. Lord, let me be activated into the harvest. Lord, let me be sent out, God, as an apostolic warrior, an apostolic harvester. Lord, you're going to move among your people. God, you're going to move upon, God, not just the ministry, but God, you're moving upon the body of Christ to engage us in the harvest. We feel the swell. We feel the rise. We feel, God, the cresting. God, there's a wave up under us of the Holy Ghost that says now is the time, amen, to activate yourself in the harvest. Come on. It's not your desire to teach Bible studies. It's God that's been stirring something up in you. It's not you feeling guilty for not witnessing. It's God saying, who's going to open their mouth? Who's going to speak to that person? Who's going to tell them about what's coming? Who's going to tell them about what's available? Come on, we need to pray until a burden grips our heart, until we're in sync with what God is doing in the earth right now. Shatarabaho, ikondolomosataya. Hey, koroboho, every spirit of lethargy, every spirit of apathy, every lukewarmness, Lord, let it be shaken from us. Let it be shaken from your church. Let it be shaken, God, from the believers of truth in the earth today. And let us rise up, God, with passion, zeal, to perform it, God.
Jesus, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord said the same flood that's going to save is the same flood that's going to take people out if they're not riding the wave. Amen. We need to be on top of the wave. We need to be riding in sync with the Spirit. In the name of Jesus, Lord, let the church, God, be in tune with what you're doing. Let us be in sync with what you're saying. In the name of Jesus Christ, this is a sovereign move, God, an end time outpouring. A reaping, Lord, of the olives and the grapes of the earth. The wine and the oil. Move of the Holy Ghost that cannot be stopped. Shandorobo yeataya. Ha yeo shandereo sababahaya. Ha yeo pataya sandorobohore. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Alaboho katalala bahai etololoho rebabahaya. Yeko tololoboho shatalabaha. Yeko tololoho yerabahaya. Would you pray that God puts a burden on your heart for somebody, that you would reach somebody, amen, before the end of the year, that you would have somebody sitting in this house that was lost, that was going to hell, but because you moved in sync with the wave, amen, their life was altered, their soul was saved, and their future was forever, amen, intercepted by God. Shandarane moya, kandalana mohoye,
Kateo shetenehe, lokotorobohosata, halalamaha yotolobohoya. I wonder if we could just pray right now, like a woman without a child, a woman that wants to have a child. Amen, amen. Like Hannah prayed, would we just let a groaning come out? Would we just let a burden be birthed? Amen. Would we let the intercession come forth out of our spirit? Lord God, it's not just about having good church. You're concerned that we're involved in the harvest. Lord, we need to move of the Holy Ghost to sweep this area, God. That harvest would be reaped in this area. Lord, when the sickle comes through here, we're working with you, Lord, to receive the harvest and to gather the harvest, oh God, for your time has come, Lord, that you will move and you're shaking things. You're aligning things, Lord, for the harvest of the souls of people. Oh, hashatarala. Hey, otololobo, rebarare, karara mahashoto. Andarare, oh, shatakataralaba. Hey, hey, soto kodorobo, shatarababa. Hey, la la la, horababa. Come on, friend, ride the wave. Ride the wave of the Holy Ghost. Ride the wave. Ride the wave. Hey. Shatalala ye koto. Hey, shatalalora babahaya. Koto robo siaya. Lord. 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 Shatayo mayon goyeba. Hela moro shetarabaya. Jesus, help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Hey, God, to have your vision. To have your mindset, God. To have your vision, Lord. Shatarabahaya. Ketorolohorababa. Shela la mondaya. Ekatarabahaya. Shatarabahaya. Shatarabahaya. I know we're celebrating Roe versus Wade being overturned, but we're talking about 60 million lives, and that's a travesty. But how many are dying every day and going to hell that we should be just as concerned with? Thank God for turning that murderous spirit around and bringing intervention. But God, this is your harvest. These are your souls. The devil wants us sidetracked with issues, gas prices, food shortage, formula shortage. My main focus is a shortage of harvesters, a shortage of laborers, the souls. Shata koturaba ikadobo.
souls of people, the souls that are going to live in eternity. Oh, my God. Oh, Shanai. Let it hit us, Lord. Let it grip us. Let it change us. Let it alter. Let it alter how we live. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord. Can we just thank the Lord for his goodness and his mercy to us? Thank him that he's allowed us to be in the bride of Christ tonight. Thank you, Lord, that you have crowned us, Lord, with favor, Lord Jesus. But God, we have to carry out our mission, Lord.
greater works, Lord, is on the shoulders of the church. The harvest is going to be reaped by the church and your angels. Hakuro Moshataya. Hallelujah. Shata Mahande Okoya. Can we just decide tonight that we're going to reach somebody? Can we decide that? What are we waiting on? What am I waiting on? I cross people's paths every day. It's not that I never witness or reach out, or, but it's got to become more intentional, more impassioned, more eaten up with zeal. Where it becomes not a mission, but our mission. Before we leave, would you pray with somebody, man to man, lady to lady? And this is what I want us to pray, that God, I'm committing to you to win a soul. And Lord, I'm going to do my best to have that person in this house before the end of the year. It's not hard because He's the one that's going to bring them to us. It's just a matter of us making up our minds to say, yes, Lord, I will intentionally be looking and opening up my mouth and praying and fasting, God, that you would bring me to the person that you intend for me to reach before this year is up. Because, Lord, you're going to bring a harvest of souls. We've got to do our part, Lord. The sickle's going to hit the entire earth. But, Lord, there's a sickle coming through this area, God, of harvest. Shatalalamaya. Anda deo sheanda. Lord, move on our hearts, God, as laborers. Let a passion, a fresh passion, grip our heart tonight, God. Shatalalabahaya. Hukotololoboye anda. Jesus, in your name, God. Hallelujah. 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 I appreciate you all. We're a part of what God's doing. I want to be a part of what God's doing. I want to feel the rise and ride it. Amen. God bless you. You're great people. There is refreshments waiting for you as a token of our appreciation for all of your service and hard work this summer. And 4th of July parade and Community Connect, VBS, so much work has gone on. But I want you to know we appreciate you. This is just a small token. It's all set up and ready. So back in the activity center, we're going to pray for the food so you can just go back and eat. Lord, in Jesus' name, I thank you for your people. I thank you, Lord, for meeting us here tonight. I thank you for talking to us and revealing your heart to us, your plans. God, let us be in sync with them. Lord, bless this food to our body and nourishment. Lord, bring great fellowship amongst us and let us enjoy one another's company in Jesus' name.
Amen. God bless you tonight.